Matthew 23. 1. Then said Jesus spoke to the multitudes. This warning was highly useful, that, amidst contentions and the noise of combats, amidst the trouble and confusion of public affairs, amidst the destruction of proper and lawful order, the authority of the Word of God might remain entire. The design of Christ was, that the people might not, in consequence of being offended at the vices of the scribes, 88, throw away reverence for the law. For we know how prone the minds of men are to entertain dislike of the law, and more especially when the life of their pastors is dissolute, and does not correspond to their words, almost all grow wanton through their example, as if they had received permission to sin with impunity. The same thing happens, and something worse, when contentions arise, for the greater part of men, having thrown off the yoke, give utterance to their wicked desires, and break out into extreme contempt. At that time the scribes burned with covetousness and swelled with ambition, their extortions were notorious, their cruelty was formidable, and such was their corruption of manners, that one would think they had conspired for the destruction of the law. Besides, they had perverted by their false opinions the pure and natural meaning of the law, so that Christ was constrained to enter into a sharp conflict with them, because their amazing rage hurried them on to extinguish the light of truth. So then, because there was danger that many persons, partly on account of such abuses, and partly on account of the din of controversies, would come to despise all religion, Christ seasonably meets them, and declares that it would be unreasonable if, on account of the vices of men, true religion were to perish, or reverence for the law to be in any degree diminished. As the scribes were obstinate and inveterate enemies, and as they held the church oppressed through their tyranny, Christ was compelled to expose their wickedness, for if good and simple men had not been withdrawn from bondage to them, the door would have been shut against the gospel. There was also another reason. For the common people think themselves at liberty to do whatever they see done by their rulers, whose corrupt manners they form into a law. But that no man might put a different interpretation on what he was about to say, he begins by stating, that whatever sort of men the teachers were, it was altogether unreasonable, either that on account of their filth the word of God should receive any stain, or that on account of their wicked examples men should hold themselves at liberty to commit sin. And this wisdom ought to be carefully observed, for many persons, having no other object in view than to bring hatred and detestation on the wicked and ungodly, mix and confound everything through their inconsiderate zeal. All discipline is despised, and shame is trampled underfoot. In short, there remains no respect for what is honorable, and, what is more, many are emboldened by it, and intentionally blazon the sins of priests, that they may have a pretext for sinning with less restraint. But in attacking the scribes, Christ proceeds in such a manner, that he first vindicates the law of God from contempt. We must attend to this caution also if we desire that our reproofs should be of any service. But, on the other hand, we ought to observe, that no dread of giving offense prevented Christ from exposing ungodly teachers as they deserved, only he preserved such moderation, that the doctrine of God might not come to be despised on account of the wickedness of men. To inform us that he spoke publicly about their vices, not to raise envy against their persons, but to prevent the contagion from spreading more widely, Mark expressly states that he spoke to them in his doctrine, by which words he means that the hearers were profitably warned to beware of them. Now, though Luke appears to restrict it to the disciples, yet it is probable that the discourse was addressed indiscriminately to the whole multitude, which appears more clearly from Matthew, and, indeed, the subject itself required that Christ should have his eye on all without exception. Matthew 23. 2. In the chair of Moses. Reasons were not wanting for inserting here what Luke relates at a different place. Besides that the doctrine is the same, I have no doubt that Luke, after having said that the scribes were sharply and severely reproved by our Lord, added also the other reproofs which Matthew delayed till the proper place, for already we have frequently seen that the evangelists, as occasion required, collected into one place various discourses of Christ. But as the narrative of Matthew is more full, I choose rather to take his words as the subject of exposition. Our Lord gives a general exhortation to believers to beware of conforming their life to the wicked conduct of the scribes, but, on the contrary, to regulate it by the rule of the law which they hear from the mouth of the scribes, for it was necessary, as I have lately hinted, that he should reprove many abuses in them, that the whole people might not be infected. Lest, through their crimes, the doctrine of which they were the ministers and heralds should be injured, he enjoins believers to attend to their words, and not to their actions, as if he had said, that there is no reason why the bad examples of pastors should hinder the children of God from holiness of life. That the word scribes, agreeably to the Hebrew idiom, denotes the teachers or expounders of the law, is well known, and it is certain that Luke calls the same persons lawyers. Now our Lord refers peculiarly to the Pharisees, who belonged to the number of the scribes, because at that time this sect held the highest rank in the government of the church, and in the exposition of Scripture. For we have formerly mentioned that, while the Sadducees and Essenes preferred the literal interpretation of Scripture, the Pharisees followed a different manner of teaching, which had been handed down, as it were, to them by their ancestors, which was, to make subtle inquiries into the mystical meaning of Scripture. This was also the reason why they received their name, for they are called Pharusim, that is, expounders. And though they had debased the whole of Scripture by their false opinions, yet, as they plumed themselves on that popular method of instruction, their authority was highly esteemed in explaining the worship of God and the rule of holy life. The phrase ought, therefore, to be thus interpreted: the Pharisees and other scribes, or, the scribes, among whom the Pharisees are the most highly esteemed, when they speak to you, are good teachers of a holy life, but by their works they give you very bad instructions, and therefore attend to their lips rather than to their hands. It may now be asked, ought we to submit to all the instructions of teachers without exception? For it is plain enough, that the scribes of that age had wickedly and basely corrupted the law by false inventions, had burdened wretched souls by unjust laws, and had corrupted the worship of God by many superstitions, but Christ wishes their doctrine to be observed, as if it had been unlawful to oppose their tyranny. The answer is easy. He does not absolutely compare any kind of doctrine with the life, but the design of Christ was, to distinguish the holy law of God from their profane works. For to sit in the chair of Moses is nothing else than to teach, according to the law of God, how we ought to live. And though I am not quite certain whence the phrase is derived, yet there is probability in the conjecture of those who refer it to the pulpit which Ezra erected, from which the law was read aloud, Nehemiah 8:4, certainly, when the rabbis expounded Scripture, those who were about to speak rose up in succession, but it was perhaps the custom that the law itself should be proclaimed from a more elevated spot. That man, therefore, sits in the chair of Moses who teaches, not from himself, or at his own suggestion, but according to the authority and word of God. But it denotes, at the same time, a lawful calling, for Christ commands that the scribes should be heard, because they were the public teachers of the church. The papists reckon it enough, that those who issue laws should possess the title and occupy the station, for in this way they torture the words of Christ to mean, that we are bound to receive obediently whatever the ordinary prelates of the church enjoin. But this calumny is abundantly refuted by another injunction of Christ, when he bids them beware of the leaven of the Pharisees, Matthew 16:6. If Christ pronounces it to be not only lawful, but even proper, to reject whatever of their own the scribes mingle with the pure doctrine of the law, certainly we are not bound to embrace, without discrimination or the exercise of judgment, whatever they are pleased to enjoin. Besides, if Christ had intended here to bind the consciences of his followers to the commandments of men, there would have been no good ground for what he said in another passage, that it is in vain to worship God by the commandments of men, Matthew 15:9. Hence it is evident, that Christ exhorts the people to obey the scribes, only so far as they adhere to the pure and simple exposition of the law. for the exposition of Augustine is accurate, and in accordance with Christ's meaning, that the scribes taught the law of God while they sat in the chair of Moses, and, therefore, that the sheep ought to hear the voice of the shepherd by them, as by hirelings. To which words he immediately adds, God therefore teaches by them, but if they wish to teach anything of their own, refuse to hear, refuse to do them. With this sentiment accords what the same writer says in his fourth book of Christian doctrine, because good believers do not obediently listen to any sort of man, but to God himself, therefore we may profitably listen even to those whose lives are not profitable. It was, therefore, not the chair of the scribes, but the chair of Moses, that constrained them to teach what was good, even when they did not do what was good. For what they did in their life was their own, but the chair of another man did not permit them to teach what was their own. Matthew 23. 4. For they bind heavy and intolerable burdens. He does not charge the scribes with oppressing and tyrannizing over souls by harsh and unjust laws, for, though they had introduced many superfluous ceremonies, as is evident from other passages, yet Christ does not at present refer to that vice, because his design is to compare right doctrine with a wicked and dissolute life. That the law of God should be called a heavy and intolerable burden is not wonderful, and more especially in reference to our weakness. But though the scribes required nothing but what God had enjoined, yet Christ reproves the stern and rigid manner of teaching which was usually followed by those proud hypocrites, who authoritatively demand from others what they owe to God, and are rigorous in enforcing duties, and yet indolently dispense with the performance of what they so strictly enjoin on others, and allow themselves to do whatever they please. In this sense Ezekiel 34:4 reproaches them for ruling with sternness and rigor. For those who truly fear God, though they sincerely and earnestly endeavor to bring their disciples to obey him, yet as they are more severe towards themselves than towards others, they are not so rigid in exacting obedience, and, being conscious of their own weakness, kindly forgive the weak. But it is impossible to imagine anything that can exceed the insolence in commanding, or the cruelty, of stupid despisers of God, because they give themselves no concern about the difficulty of doing those things from which they relieve themselves, and therefore no man will exercise moderation in commanding others, unless he shall first become his own teacher.